Hey, what's going on, everybody? Welcome back to Unchained Cinema, and today I am joined once again by my co-host Jason and my wonderful sister Kate. So initially we were going to do the experiment with her, because her background as a corrections officer in Charleston County would have been absolutely perfect for that. I screwed up the planning, so me and Jason just did it last night. But just to kind of kick it off, we're going to talk a little bit about the experiment, but we're also going to do like we did with Bob, kind of, you know, just get to know this person. And I'm sure she probably has some stories about me, because she remembers things that I don't. But so just starting off, Kate, you know, you watched the experiment. What were your thoughts on that movie?
All right. I'll start out positive. It kept me entertained. It kept my attention the whole time, but I was disappointed it didn't represent the actual experiment. When you read about the actual experiment, it doesn't even really resemble what happened. And I was kind of hoping for something a little more representative. It was rushed. And I felt that it was over-dramatized. But they were trying to sell it to everybody, and I get that. You know, they want money. But as far as just sitting back and being entertained, it was fine. It touched on some ugly parts about human nature, but I don't think they did a good job leading up to what provokes people to that, you know, to get to that state, especially if it's not natural for them. It's not, you know, a way they're generally going to behave. You know, some people are born evil, but I don't think the people that they brought into this experiment, they weren't really career criminals. They were college kids, you know. And even though the movie showed, you know, one ex-con did, you know, slip in, he seemed to be one of the most stable ones there. At least he knew what was up, and that part was realistic. You bring an ex-con into even a fake jail situation, they're going to know how to handle it.
Yeah. And that's something we touched on last night, is, you know, you don't get this kind of reaction out of people if it's not coerced. And if you go back and watch the documentary, and I posted a card in the last video to the documentary that I watched, it wasn't a natural situation like you were talking about. It wasn't college kids going into a prison. Let's see what happens. Mm-hmm. They actually told the guards, they're like, you need to be hated. You know, you have to have this persona. And that's kind of what amped up the main guy, the guy with the longer blonde hair. And he's like, all right, well, let's see where I can take this. So yeah, absolutely. But as from a corrections officer perspective, is there anything that kind of stood out in your mind?
There's a lot that stood out. And I had to keep reminding myself that it was an experiment. This isn't real jail. So there, you know, I see all the things that happened in that movie? Can I see people being pushed to that point? Yes, but not in the way they did it. It didn't add up. I don't think it represented the way people really would have reacted to each scenario that was presented. And it was it's hard to have an opinion about this because it is so Hollywood and so staged. That's about all I can tell you about it. That is not how I believe college kids, or even if I were to bring a bunch of inmates into a situation like that, they would have handled it better. Every group has its jerk, but I've watched even the weakest links in a unit, dorm, pod, whatever you want to call it, you know, stand up for themselves far more than some of the stronger characters in this show. And, you know, even the most beta of males wouldn't have been as submissive as what I saw. There's no way.
Interesting. And one of the parallels that I came to is, you know, you were in the military. Mm-hmm. And maybe your experience is a little different than mine. I've seen people in that situation where you have the junior soldier or airman who just gets messed with to the point where they turn into this monstrosity. Have you ever experienced that?
I have seen that, but it's, they don't, I have never seen them lose themselves so completely. I'm not saying it doesn't happen. I'm sure it does, but I've never seen anybody lose themselves so completely that they couldn't be brought back. You know, they've had years of being who they are. And then, you know, a few months or maybe a year of being crapped on isn't going to change who they are fundamentally. I think you can still bring that back. And I also think a lot of people recognize when, or hopefully they do. And again, it's not every scenario, but and for the most part, they can recognize when they push somebody way too far and they'll backpedal. They'll be like, oh, okay, we really fucked this. Or sorry, we really messed this up now. And they start showing more mercy, even the most, you know, it's hard to tell in the jail because there's a pecking order and they regulate themselves. They view in their culture, in that subculture, in that environment, you picking on the weak makes you weak. They recognize that. And it is dealt with. It's not to say that, you know, the weaker people don't get robbed or taken advantage of. And again, I'm talking about jail, not prison. Prison's a whole different animal. I've never worked in a prison. I've just heard things. I can't speak on prison, but in jail, yeah, they're by and large very supportive of each other. There is a pecking order. There is some bullying, but I see a limit to it. I don't see this unbridled rage and aggression and all the things that we saw on the experiment in a matter of 6 days. No. And these are, you know, I was working in a max security area that most of these guys have either been to prison or are heading to prison. A lot of people in for all kinds of heinous stuff and they don't. Yeah. All right. We've got college kids, right? Even our most hardened inmates would step in if somebody appears to be, even if they hate them, appears to be dying of, you know, because they need their insulin or, you know, they will, I've seen it over and over again. They will look out for each other just for, you know, just for humanity's sake. Yeah,
the human nature.
But
I have a question while you're thinking. So maybe you can answer this. And I was thinking when you mentioned, you know, there's a pecking order, that brought something to my attention. And Chris and I didn't really talk about this in the initial video. So maybe you can elaborate more since you've had experience. So you said there's a pecking order, you know, when they go to prison, jail, whatever, there's like some defined, you know, roles that people fall into. It sounds like what you're alluding to. Maybe the reason why, and again, you can correct me if I'm wrong, because I could be completely out of line on this, but in the real world, there's those defined roles or pecking order because these people have a history, they have a name, they have a, they're associated with an organization or a group or whatever. So people kind of know who these people are because of what they did or because of who they are, whatnot. But, you know, so maybe those people know not to mess with certain people. You kind of know where you fall, right? But
there's a clear defined order. There's no right. question where you stand. Yeah.
So with the movie, The Experiment, none of them have that, right? They're all thrown in the same boat together. So no one really knows, like, who's going to be the alpha.
This is true. But I tell you, even when we let's say when we if we assemble a new group and most of the people aren't familiar with each other, it takes minutes to figure out where most people go. If nothing else, inmates have an intuition about other people that is uncanny. They can see right through you, and they're watching every move you make, and they just it's really interesting to watch. But they can presume all kinds of things about you just within the first few minutes of knowing you, and they're usually right.
Interesting. I like it.
Yeah, so I have a question for you because Jason and I decided to agree to disagree. And at the end of the movie, when, you know, it's discussed, because you can kind of tell the whole thing's evolution, right? I mean, from the beginning to the end of the movie, it's like, how are we different than monkeys? And he says something to the effect of, you know, we have evolved past that because we still have that hope that we can transcend these things. I feel that's true because, you know, we have that human nature. And, you know, when you're put in a situation like that, you have the ability to step back, where the animalistic instinct doesn't have that. Monkeys will go at it until one is dead. Jason disagreed with my assertion. And if you want to elaborate on that, Jason, go ahead. I just want to see kind of where you're at with that.
I'm not trying to interrupt you, Jason, but you got to take mental illness into consideration. There's a lot of that, and they will beat you till you're dead. They don't care. There's a piece missing.
That's what I was saying. That's what I agree. I told Chris, there are some people, or anybody, could be pushed to the breaking point. Mm-hmm. And even though there's, like, at the end of the movie, like, Chris and I kind of disagreed, you know, when the lights came on and the sirens were going off and all that stuff, he said, you know, that's when they stopped. You know, they realized, you know, it stopped. And I go, well, yeah, because just like if you saw two dogs fighting and you interrupt them, they're going to stop fighting. But my point to him was that if that light didn't come on, they're going to kill each other. They will kill each other. And Chris was saying, no, human nature is going to step in and they're going to finally realize they're going to break it off. And I'm like, no, that is not what I believe will happen.
Mm-hmm. No, you're right. Once you get past that, I've seen people past that certain point. And you can't, you know, it takes three people to pull somebody off of somebody. They just lose it. Adrenaline is powerful. Adrenaline's really powerful. You black out.
So I guess where I looked at it was more from the holistic perspective. You know, we have the outliers that would go to that because of mental illness and things. But I'm talking about as the whole.
Yeah, Monty touched on this. He had said, when he was watching this, he said, you know, about this fighting scene, he said, I wouldn't stop. I don't care if those lights come on. You keep going. That's how he's wired. Maybe it just depends on the individual. And I know a lot of individuals that I worked around. I'm not saying COs, because we're not allowed to. You know, there are so many rules now. We're not allowed to express any kind of aggressive or violent tendencies at all, you know, lawsuits. But as far as the inmates are concerned, when I think back to all the fights I've viewed, they'll come in, our SWAT team will come in and shoot off a shot. This thing is just loud as all get out. They'll shoot a shotgun in there with a big old rubber bullet. It just sends shockwaves through the unit. And, you know, when they're in there yelling, and you still got people that you can't pull apart, you know, that's your light. Like, you better stop now or life's going to get painful. And they just keep going at it. So I'm wondering how realistic it was for, all of a sudden the lights come on and everybody just stops. I don't know. I guess it would just depend on the people, but Monty didn't believe he would stop.
Interesting.
Do you think you would stop?
Me?
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. But I think it comes down to the individual.
Oh, yeah. Prior to working where I worked, I would have said, yes, I would have stopped immediately. After working where I worked, I can tell you right now, I wouldn't stop. I would, because I've been in that adrenaline state and you don't know what you're doing. I'm pretty sure I wouldn't.
I guess, you know, where am I? Line of thought. I've been in a circumstance like that, and I had a guy when I first came in the Army, and he wanted to spar with me because I was a Marine and he felt he was out to prove something. And the first thing I told this dude is, like, dude, no cheap shots. The first thing this dude guy does is box my ears, and I blacked out, and yeah. I threw him down, and I had his trachea basically pushed between my forearm and my other hand, pushing down on his neck, and I snapped out of it. And I was like, oh, you know, what am I doing?
Oh, yeah, I see what you're saying. All right.
So I've been pushed kind of to that point, but it, you know, granted, the situation is not the same.
But you haven't been tortured for X amount of days, months, or years either. True. So there are so many variables. Yeah, I mean, if it was just a, you know, if somebody was just fighting me and I was like about, yeah, I don't know. I don't know, Chris. I would like to think that, yeah, and I don't know. I don't know. It depends on, I think it's, you know, you're in survival mode. It depends on so much. I don't know where to go with that. That's touchy.
Yeah.
But I feel like at the end, like what Chris and I were both said at the end, I go, you know, for me, I did enjoy the way it ended because it was, I guess, quasi ambiguous for us because we both looked at it from a different perspective, you know, like I walked away from it going like, that's not real life. Like you and I are kind of on the same agreement. Like just because the lights came on and the sirens went off, that does not tell me I'm stopping. Like I'm finishing what I started or whatever.
Yeah.
And he sees that and he walks away from it like, yeah, that makes sense. So I will give the director or the writer or whatever some accolades there because, you know, and I even mentioned before, it's like when you see a car wreck, all three of us can see the same car wreck, but we're going to come at it from three different ways. So even though they filmed it for this specific purpose, I looked at it different than Chris did. That doesn't mean he's right or I'm wrong or vice versa. It was just a very interesting, it's where you're built. Like kind of what you're mentioning, like with you and Monty or whatever. Like when you look at that, you look at it from a different perspective.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Yeah. Would I keep doing something lethal, Chris? Probably not. But would I keep swinging? Probably. Probably. Just because you get, once you're pushed past that point, you can't hear or see much of anything.
I mean, would that go back to a lot of times people, like the crimes of passion, you know, like, you know, things people do in the heat of the moment, you know, like if you have that internal good guy, you know, whatever in you every time, like the little Jiminy Cricket on your shoulder, it would cause everybody to stop doing those heat of passion, like murders or like terrible things. Right. But people get to that point where they just snap and you want to think the best of yourself or others, but all you see is red. And before you know it, you've already done something you can't take back, you know? So that's kind of how I looked at it. So I was going to ask you this because I thought this was interesting and maybe this is something you can speak to also, because Chris and I were talking and it's something that I don't really, you know, it's played always in like all kind of prison type movies or like movies involving like jail or whatnot of guards and inmates or whatnot or prisoners having like kind of like a flex moment, like in like the where they're eating and they're like refusing to adhere to what they're supposed to eat or like listening to simple commands, like pushing each other, you know, to see like who's gonna get the upper hand. Like, you know, do you see that on a regular basis where like certain inmates or prisoners like trying to establish like you're not in charge, I'm in charge, or like the prison guards or you know guards, they have to establish who's the boss, like the alpha male from the get-go with new people. Like, what does that really look like opposed to like what Hollywood tries to make it look like?
Okay. If I think I know what you're asking, if I'm off track, let me know. We're challenged as COs, we're challenged every day. They want to see how far they can push it. Would I ever dream of telling somebody to finish their plate? Not a chance.
Right, sure.
No, they don't want to finish their plate. They don't finish it. I don't do those power moves on it, and it wouldn't work anyway.
It's
ridiculous. If I tried to force it as a male, as a female, they would just brush me off. But if as a male and I tried to force somebody to do something like that, at best, they would just throw their tray away, walk away with some choice words. You know, at worst, I would get clocked with that tray without question. I mean, again, these were college students playing a game, but this would never happen in a jail setting. And if it did, you know, oh my gosh. Yeah, I don't know one inmate that would put up with that from a CO. It might have been different in this. I know jail was very, very different in the 70s. COs had a lot more freedom to do what they wanted, which I disagree with on so many levels because there was a lot of abuse of power. I'm very, very opposed to that. It's not okay. So, you know, I'm sure all kinds of horrible things happened. You know, they with I know there, I've heard stories. There were all kinds of horrible things that happened back in the day. But today, no, no. Do you mean that, like, as far? Did I answer that, or?
You answer. You did answer it, but I guess my thinking is that, you know, the whole idea that the whole premise of the movie is, mm-hmm. and even what Chris mentioned, and I think you did too, is like they're trying to get a reaction out of people, right? They're trying to have, a purposeful like agitation, be agitated. Okay. But in the real world, like in a real situation, you would think that you want to de-escalate any of those kind of situations. So
we are trained to de-escalate. That is the first thing we are trained to do. Like above anything, just try to de-escalate at first. That's key right there. Yeah.
Okay. I would think that now, like you said, maybe 20 years ago, 30 years ago, whatever, it was a different mindset. You know, you were like cracking skulls or whatever kind of attitude, like show who's the boss or whatnot. But now, you know, there's so many, you know, the world we live in, that's just not applicable anymore. That's just not realistic.
No.
And so, but that doesn't mean that if you're dealing with terrible people, they're still going to try to push and see how far they can go with, I guess, COs or like whatever they're dealing with to see like what they can get away with. I would assume that's still a very common thing you have to deal with every single day with
every people. Day, every sometimes every minute. If you walk in there new, it's every minute. Yeah, they're gonna play the little games and just like a child, see how far they can push it, just to see what they can get away with when you're on shift. It's very normal. And I wanna also add that just because it's not okay in this day and age, it doesn't mean it doesn't happen. You know, abuse of power, it does happen. It's not, if it's found out about, it is not tolerated by administration. Hopefully, at least it wasn't in my jail. But it's seven, from what I hear though, the 60s and 70s, it was Wild West out there. So
I can only imagine.
No holds barred. It sounded pretty hellish.
Well, I mean, I would assume that both of you all could speak to it, and maybe even Chris more than now, but wouldn't it be true that when you were in the military, when you joined in just 10 years ago, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, is quite different than the way it is now with people coming in and out. I would assume like the things that you got away with back then would never fly now with the way people brought in and the way people are treated or whatnot. I mean, again, correct me if I'm wrong, but again, it's the image as a person, like a civilian on the outside looking in, that you would think it was completely different than it is now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's pretty watered down. COVID didn't help. And you see a drastic change in the quality and caliber of people coming out of those training programs. It's taken a steep nosedive. I think a lot of that has to do with the culture and how the, I don't know what generation we're in now, but you know, how they're raised. But you couple that with the less intense training and the, I'm not going to say coddling, because I know the drill sergeants and drill instructors are out there trying to do their thing, but yeah, they are constrained. And I think a lot of that has to do with some of those abuses of power. And that stuff still happens, you know, people getting in trouble for, you know, sleeping with the privates and quid pro quo kind of stuff. You know, physical violence. I know I was manhandled a couple times when I went through, but that was 20 years ago. And does it still happen? Probably. If you're found guilty of doing something like that, you're probably dealt with quick, fast, and in a hurry, and you're out of there and your career is over. So that's just kind of the dynamic from what I've seen.
Yeah, when I was going through what the Army calls A school, we called tech school, we had real trash leadership in our dorm, and some, I won't get into details, but there were a few airmen that got really hurt because of carelessness and just simply abuse of power. And there was a big old investigation. They kept their jobs, got a slap on the wrist. Today it would be a big news event. Yeah, they were Garbage, absolute garbage. I'm glad things have changed for the better in some ways. I don't think a watered down version of the military that's turning out weak professionals is a good idea, but something needed to change. I wish I could find a good balance.
So as you probably have seen, you've already watched before, Kate, that, you know, we have done a couple of these episodes where we talk to people. We're all around the same age and have similar experiences, even though we didn't live in the same area, but we grew up in the same decade or decades. And we've all had the opportunity to kind of have shared experiences, maybe especially since this is a film, cinema, movie type of show. We kind of like to ask people questions about what it was like for them growing up at the time they did. What were some of the highlights of cinema and film? And then kind of just like, you know, talk a little bit about that and kind of just see where the conversation goes. So with that being said, you know, you and I are around the exact same age, so that's cool. So I'm interested to ask these specific questions to you and just, like we said, see where it goes. So the first one being, what is your first memory of watching a movie, no matter if it's set up, you know, in a theater, on VHS, on TV? What is your very first memory of watching something as far as the movie is concerned?
I was 4, and the Pink Panther movie had just come out.
Nice.
The 4-year-old, I'm looking at, you know, my favorite colors, pink, and I like cats, so I'm like, oh, okay. And then they kept advertising it a lot on TV, so I'm all excited about this, thinking it would have something to do, at least in part, with the cartoon version of the Pink Panther.
Right.
I begged and begged and begged Dad to take me. Mom wasn't interested, and Dad finally took a day off of work and took me to see it. And of course I was bored to tears, but I wasn't going to admit it because I fought to see this thing. And I was really happy to be spending time with him. So that was cute. Sure. And then the second one was, Chris, the one you and I discussed of Return of the Jedi in the drive-in movie theater.
So we went to go see the Pink Panther. You did go see it in the theater. So that was your first kind of like experience in the theater. That was, I guess, because you saw the TV spots or the trailers on TV that got you excited for what you thought was going to be a Pink Panther cartoon animation thing, right?
Yeah, I knew it wasn't fully animated, but I thought, you know, it would be, I thought he would play a, you know, the cartoon character would play a bigger part, not realize what it was really about.
Sure. Yeah, Peter Sellers tricked you from there. Yeah, he got you. He got you show up in the theater. He's like, American. All right, so Pink Panther was that. That's awesome. That is good. I would never imagine that in a million years. Cause I do remember that too, but yeah, that's just like you said, it's pink and it's a cat. So it's like, you know, I can see where you're gravitating towards that. So mm-hmm. That being said, what was like your first like movie experience as far as VHS? Like, you know, I know we kind of talked before that there was a local shop, VHS mom and pop store that you were aware of that you went to, but that might not have been the first time. What was the first time you remember going and maybe picking out your own movie, got so excited you took it home and you wanted to watch it either with your mom or dad or with friends? Like, what was that, if you can remember?
It was, I don't remember the name of the shop, but it was when we were living in Pontiac. It was downtown in a little strip mall, and it was walking distance from the house. So mom used to walk Chris and I over to pick out whatever movie that we wanted. And like Chris, I remember Chris, you talking about how you'd start out bold and work your way back. I would do the same thing. And, you know, it's funny, the best cover art was always on the horror movies. Always. It was always the most intriguing, eye-catching cover art. Yeah. So we would naturally go over there. Mom would get upset, steer us back to the family movies. But we would start out bold and like wind our way back until we got to something that we could agree on. That was very familiar when he said that. I'd forgotten about that, Chris, until you said that. And I couldn't tell you, you know, I didn't have any special attachment to any one movie there, you know, that I remember like, oh, I really need to see this. It was always new and exciting every time you walked in. It was always something different I wanted to see, but it was an event, and we enjoyed it.
Now, And I know Chris and I probably talked about this a little bit before, and I'm going to try to refrain from talking about my own personal experience, because I'm sure I've mentioned it already. But even though you might not have remembered like the very first VHS you checked out, did you have one or a couple films that you would go back and watch multiple times that you'd want to be like, you love that movie so much, you'd be like, I want to go check it out, like, you know, five times in a matter of like 2 months or something. Yep. Like, every time it came out, you're like, I want dad, take me, I want to go see such and such.
The Care Bear movie.
Yes. Care Bear's
and
there.
Then finally it came out on TV where they were playing it over and over and over again.
Oh, yeah.
The one where they go to camp. I don't remember which one.
Yeah. Uh-huh. That's awesome. Care Bears. Yeah. I remember that. Do you remember that, Chris? Were you watching some Care Bears back then too, buddy?
I do remember that. I wanted to be the little kid in that cartoon so bad. I thought he was so awesome.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I could see where. Yeah. Okay.
That was a sweet jogging suit too.
Right. I know. Yeah. The little girl was pretty cool too. So yeah, Care Bear.
Care Bears.
And Chris, you were talking about Rainbow Bright.
It was Rainbow Bright or My Little Pony. I can't remember which one it was, but he had this like laser thing on his wrist, and I wanted that so bad. So I took my Legos and I put them together, and I rubber banded it to my arm, and I would run around the house with my laser.
I think that was Rainbow Bright.
Yeah, I think it's Rainbow Bright. Yeah.
And I remember riding your strawberry shortcake bike around. I didn't have a bike, so I had the pink and red little frilly things on the handlebars, and it had strawberry shortcake on the little baskets.
I don't remember that. That's interesting. I remember they eventually got you a BMX bike.
Yes, but before I had that, I had the Transformers big wheel.
Yes, you did. That was a big deal. Yeah.
Introducing the Transformers Power Cycle. You can imagine a world of adventures.
Look, they're attacking the power plant.
The Transformers, more than we see.
Time to transform into a robot.
The Transformers.
Miss, but I won't. Mission away. Back to cycle mode. What kind of wheels you got?
More than meets the eye.
The Transformers Power Cycle. New from Coleco.
Yeah, Transformers Big Wheel. Nice.
When something hits you, like you could hit the front and it would flip over and it was like damaged. Dude, it was so cool. And then my cousin broke it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. The little, yep. The rotating piece in there that made it look like I forgot about. Dang.
Yeah.
Good memory.
Is it Brad? Our cousin Brad broke my big wheel.
You better tell him that he owes you that. You better call him up and be like, yo, I better see a brand new big wheel in my front yard when I come back and it next year.
Yeah, I was pretty butthurt about that. That was like my favorite thing.
If he kept it new in the box, could you imagine? You could have sold that thing for...
Oh my gosh, that'd be big money.
Yeah, I didn't know that like digital media is commanding a pretty big price right now, because I told you I had the Ilsa collection. It was Ilsa, She-Wolf of the SS, and there was two other movies in there, The Wicked Warden and I forget what the Tigress. Yeah, and I sold that box that I bought it for like $20 at one of those Sam Goody or something that was going out of business, and I sold it for like $80 or $90 about 15 years ago. And the other one I saw was Rose Red. Another channel I watched, Sinister Cinema, did an episode on Rose Red, and he's like, I was trying to find a copy, and the cheapest I could find it in the States was $80. So it's just interesting how, you know, we're going away from the physical media, and like now there's a calling for it, for the nostalgia.
So I can just speak about that for just a minute, not to go down too much of a rabbit hole, but the main things why you see that now happening, it's a couple things. It's that everybody's used to now streaming services. That's pretty much how everyone's getting their information. But guess what? What happens when that movie is no longer a part of that streaming service? What happens if they just pull it off? What happens if you download it? Like, you know, you download an app or whatever to stream it, and they no longer, or you bought it, but they no longer have the rights to it. They pull it away from you. So,
and then like, censorship. Issues.
And that's what I was getting ready to get to, because that's my soapbox now, because they're going through and censoring everything. And sometimes you don't even know they're censoring it until you buy it or you start watching it. And if you've seen the original, you know there's certain things that are missing from it or whatever the case may be. And a lot of these major streaming services is because we live in this woke world now that apparently you have to force people to watch something, even though you have this thing called a clicker. And you're going to be like, click, I don't want to watch this, it offends me, and turn it off. Instead of people having that freedom to do that, they're taking that freedom away from you and just taking it out of it altogether. And so people are going through and buying all this physical media because that's the last place you're going to be able to find it. Because one, it won't just disappear one day, or two, they'll show it to you, but they show you what they want you to watch, and not what not the actual art that the director or the actors or whatever want to portray. And then you make the decision if you wanted to, you know, take it in or not, you know, wanted to have, you know, let it, you know, observe it. And so, I mean, if you watch a lot of these things now, like on HBO or Disney or Hulu or whatever, there's sometimes now trigger warnings before the movie to let you know if they're going to show it to you in the full capacity that it might trigger you to watch it. Like there's one in front of Dumbo now, because the crows are misconstrued as like black caricatures. Like what 7-year-old or 5-year-old kid is watching that movie going, yeah, those crows, those definitely are like black caricatures, but they do stuff like that now. And you're just like, what are you doing? What world do we live in? So that's what we're talking about now.
I know they've been putting a disclaimer now, Disney has, before a lot of their movies, saying this was done prior to what we're doing now. You know, this was done before XYZ had been monitored. That I would prefer, I don't mind that. You want to put your little disclaimer on there, fine. But yeah, don't chop it up.
Right.
Don't like it. Fast forward through.
But now, what I'm saying is that they're finding every kind of movie that has any minor transgression, possibly, they're throwing those disclaimers on everything now. So especially like a channel like Disney, who has done stuff like that, they do that, and it's just like, but no one's thinking that unless you put it in there. It's like introducing ideas to children who aren't thinking along those lines. But now that you've introduced it to them, now they're looking for it, or now they're hearing it, or now they're like observing it. And it's before they wouldn't even think about it. So it's like, oh, there's scenes in here that's inappropriate. What's inappropriate about it? So anyway, regardless of all that, you know, you have a lot of that going on now. So
with as violent as Disney is, I find it interesting that they're nitpicking what they're nitpicking. Now, I don't want to offend people. I don't like it when people are offended. But again, that's what the disclaimers are for. And yet they still keep in all these, you know, these bits and pieces that I know a lot of us found traumatizing.
Tipper Gore's behind this, isn't
violence she? Is perfectly okay, but let's get rid of all this other stuff.
So I mean, and like I said, at the end of the day, it's other people telling you what they think is acceptable or not, or what may be offensive to another person, maybe not. So just instead of letting parents or individuals make those determinations themselves, they're doing it for you. So that's the reason why you start to see physical media becoming more and more, I guess, go up in price and become more and more desirable, because those things you don't have to worry about. That's why you see behind me and you can't even see everything. It's just nothing but physical media behind me, because that's what I collect. I don't trust that it's going to be there anymore, quite frankly. Or if it's going to be there, it's going to be a snipped, censored version. So
Tipper Gore and the PMRC are still alive and well.
What's the PMRC? I don't know.
You don't remember that back in the 80s when Tipper Gore and all her cohorts were trying to like censor?
Oh yeah. But it's kind of funny, because now it's been like flipped on its ear. Now those people, you know, that group of people are the ones censoring, like out of control. You know, it's like out of you know, it's so intense. The censorship now, they don't want anybody to see or hear anything they don't want you to see or hear. It's crazy. But anyways, I did want to ask you a question real quick to kind of get back to where we were going, Kate, about something. So when you all got to, as you had gotten older, now I'm assuming you did sleepovers with friends, or you went to friends' house to sleepovers. So what were some of those? Like, again, growing up in the 80s, I'm assuming you had experiences like I did, like getting a movie, getting a pizza, hanging out with your girlfriends. I like, that was a thing. Like, you live for the weekend. So mm-hmm. you're like, you know, later elementary school, into middle school, maybe even to high school. Like, we would all get together and watch movies and do that. Do you have any specific memories of, like, doing those things? Like, what movies were you and your friends watching? What were you all talking, you know, what were some of your, like, highlights growing up as far as movies with your buddies or friends?
That's a good question. Yeah, there are a lot of memories, a lot of sleepovers on a lot of weekends.
Sure.
Lots of pizza, cake, soda, all that. Of course, you always had your friends, like the house you described, where they're allowed to watch whatever they want. So that's where you go to watch what you've always wanted to watch. That's where I saw Faces of Death, Chris. Was that Purpose's?
Oh, gosh. Yeah, that didn't happen in my house.
Yeah.
That's intense. That's awesome.
Yeah.
If you wanted to watch something you couldn't watch at home, you went to the Purpose house.
That's
where I saw Sleepaway Camp and everything else I should have never seen. As a young impressionable child. God,
Sleepaway Camp. That final scene of Sleepaway Camp, dude, it still traumatizes me to this day.
When we were in middle school, Disney's Watcher in the Woods scared the pants off us.
Oh yeah, Watcher in the Woods. Yeah,
that's Betty a fun Davis. One. That's a fun one. But yeah, that really that was, you know, for some young girls, I was, oh my gosh, so scary. The Land Before Time always made everybody cry.
Did you ever watch the Neverending Story? Was that ever on your radar?
It was on TV. And we would just watch it over and over. You know, back when our channel selection was more limited. Yeah, a lot of Land Before Time. It was always on. Usually it felt like every weekend. Like there was a lot of Land Before Time. I'm sorry. You said Neverending Story.
Right.
Is that what you said? Yeah. Never ending story.
I love Land Before Time too, so I'm right there with you. I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, yeah. You did say Never Ending Story, right?
Yeah, Never Ending Story. Yeah, with the Trey and Artex and all that.
Yeah, that one was on constantly, just on the television. We might have, but I'm not sure we even had the VHS of that. It was just on TV so much. And Unico, that was on a lot too. Do you remember that cartoon, Jason? Chris doesn't. I asked him before. It's this.
What's it called?
My first exposure to anime, and it was called Unico. If you don't know what it is, look it up. Maybe some of the artwork will trigger a memory.
Okay, I'll check it.
Constantly. I think it was on HBO all the time. I think that's where
I'll check it out. Unico. Okay.
Yeah, and that was pretty twisted. I mean, it wasn't. I don't think they meant for it to be twisted, but it just was. It always gave you an uneasy feeling. But again, there was only so much. We didn't have, you know, round the clock cartoons, and yeah, you just
we did have the Never Ending Story.
We did
on VHS, and we taped it from the TV.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that.
Because I probably wore it out.
It was taped from the television. I thought it was on television a lot, and it was just you playing the video. That might be where my memory failed.
Could be. That's I wasn't smart enough to pause during commercials.
I remember back. I don't know if your parents were like this or whatever. But I remember my dad would like film like something off of HBO or record HBO or Showtime. And, you know, you could just hit the record button and there was a movie. So you didn't have to get up and stop the movie because it was like they showed the whole movie. Mm-hmm. But then whenever he would watch something on like regular TV that you couldn't find, I remember my dad would hit the pause button and then he'd have to hit the play button or the record button because it popped back up so he could watch it again later. That. And, you know, that was something that, you know, he ended up getting a controller eventually back in the olden days. He finally got the controller. So he just do it from the seat, from his lazy boy recliner. He just sit back and be like, all right, here we go.
Instead of sending you to do it, right?
Exactly. Jason, stop it. All right, now DJ, hit record. Yeah. Right, stop it. And I'm like, okay, Dad, right. Yes, sir. So, yeah.
Funny.
So did you have any, like, so as a family, since obviously you guys were, you know, grew up together, did you all have any you know, times where you all went to a movie together as a family or watched a movie like during the holidays as a family? Like, was there ever a time where you all kind of did like mom and dad and the kids stuff where it was like memories where a movie was involved or a theme was involved with, you know, doing like a weekend? We all went to a movie theater once every couple weekends to go see something as a family, anything like that?
I think you'll like this one, Chris. I'm pretty sure you forgot when we took our trip, Chris, to California.
Mm-hmm.
Aunt Liz lived near what is depicted in the movie Back to the Future, Twin Pines Mall.
Mm-hmm.
I have it written down somewhere because I was going to remind you of this, Chris. I don't remember the real name of the mall, but we went to that mall where they had filmed that part of Back to the Future. They had some fireworks going that weekend, so we watched the fireworks. And what had been playing, it was the tail end. It had been out on the movie circuit for a while. It wasn't going to be out that much longer, but we did watch, Chris, Back to the Future 3 at a theater very near there.
It was very
crowded. I remember having to step over some people to get to our seats, but yeah, we went to the group to see that one.
Cause that was that same trip when we went to Universal Studios Hollywood, right?
Correct. Yeah. We only did
one. I kept making dad take me to go see the Miami Vice thing with the boat jumping and blowing up.
That.
Mm-hmm. I think I made him take me like 3 times to see it. I think he was pretty upset with me. And then we did the Jaws train thing and we had one picture. We had the 35mm camera. And dad had this thing ready to go and Jaws pops out of the water and this fat tourist was like, and like he snapped a picture of the back of this dude's head and then the shark was gone.
Dad's still mad about that to this day. He still complains. That poor guy. But the other one that comes to mind in my memory was jogged with one of the other shows you guys did was we went, Chris, as a family. I really wanted to see Young Einstein with the Yahoo Sirius. I was about 9 or 10 years old. My parents didn't want to see it. So they took you, Chris, to see something more age appropriate in the same theater. I don't remember what it was. And they took me to see, or they allowed me to go see Young Einstein. That was the first movie I ever watched by myself.
I remember seeing that in the theater.
You did? Maybe you went with me then. I know they weren't.
I think I did.
They did not watch that with us. But okay, so you came with me. I thought they kept you with them. So they probably went off to see what they wanted to see. And then you came with me.
Oh, God. And you got to love it when you could actually send your kids to go do something else.
Yeah, they would.
Yeah, I'm going to skip this train wreck of a movie because this looks stupid. I'm going to go watch something that's more up my
alley. Yeah, you just separate and move on. They'd let us loose in the, you know, I'm sure, Jason, you remember, they'd let us loose in the mall and come pick us up later. I don't know if they did this with you, Chris, but they would drop us off at the skating rink and we'd be there for hours and they'd pick us up whenever.
not that I recall.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I can't imagine doing that with my daughter today. It would not happen.
No, I'm so OCD about trying to, and I don't want to be like, what's the phrase, like a helicopter parent or whatever that phrase is. Like, I'm not that person necessarily, but I'm not just dropping my kid off somewhere and just disappearing for like 2 or 3, 4 hours. So even the town I live in, like there's like, you know, like the high school basketball game. Like, you know, I let him go run and hang out with his friend. He's in middle school, but I'm still at the game. I'm not just going to just drop him off and just disappear, and then, you know, I'll come back 3 hours later. So you better believe I'm not doing that at a mall or a theater or like you always saying, like, no way. You know, once he gets into high school, probably I'll loosen a little bit. But like you said, my parents used to tell me I'm the one in charge, and I'm like in 5th grade of my brother and sister, and they just disappear. You know,
I've been babysitting Chris since I was, 8 years old, 7, 8 years old.
And here you are in 2022 doing the same thing. You know, nothing changed.
That's right.
Oh, man. So you mentioned before, I wanted to bring this up because I think it's something cool that, you know, you all mentioned to me when we first started talking, was that you're all originally from Michigan and that during the 80s, you all got to, you watched Beverly Hills Cop, but you have a little bit of a backstory about that as well from where they filmed it. And so you have a special connection there. So Chris has never mentioned this before, so I thought it'd be cool if you kind of like we talked about with Back to the Future. But what was that little, you know, experience?
Yeah, the beginning chase scene, with the beginning credits, they're driving down streets that I recognize, Chris might be too young, that I recognize as our parents having driven us down numerous times for various reasons, very familiar streets and landmarks. And what I love most about the opening scene is all of the candid shots they have of locals giving real reactions to the cameras being there, in addition to you can see people standing on their roofs watching the chase scene being filmed, which is cool. It's just a little bit of realness in there, and then something we can relate to because we grew up in the area. The architecture is familiar, you know, even if you'd never been down those streets. Michigan City homes look like Michigan City homes. And it's all very familiar. When things are filmed in California and Florida, you're gonna get a lighter, breezier kind of depiction of outside, where when you're filming in New York and Michigan and those, you know, northern states, you get that cloudiness we're so familiar with. There's always a pall in the atmosphere, and it's captured in movies filmed in the area. And again, it's recognizable, it's relatable, and I think it's more fun to watch because, you know, it's something we personally experienced. But yeah, that's my favorite scene in the movie, because it's just so, when you look in the background, it's so real.
Well, and you mentioned a really cool thing, because in Beverly Hills Cop in particular, they do film in Detroit. You know, they show you, like, legitimately the town, you know, the city of Detroit and the inner workings of the city. It's not like it was filmed in Vancouver. But then the juxtaposition is that he's actually in Beverly Hills. So then, like you said, it's like bright and sunny and palm trees and, like,
yeah,
you know, it's literally like white versus black, you know, so to speak, where it's like urban, you know, real rough, you know, tumble part of, you know, the country to this, like, real, like, almost like, you know, like, you know, almost like out of a storybook kind of thing, where everybody's like, it's clean and everything, there's space between everything and all this stuff. It's a great way to show the actual Foley character from coming from this, like, rough and tumble, like, no nonsense, like, keep your head on a swivel to like, hey man, it's all like just chill here.
I
do like that. You're exactly right. The way they filmed that was very cool. So yeah.
So Kate, I don't know if Dad ever told you this. When Dad was a claims manager for Allstate, he actually met Gil Hill, which is the guy that played Inspector Todd.
Yeah, he was an actual cop and eventually a detective in the Detroit area. If you look him up, you can find.
And he's like, yeah, he's just like that in real life.
In the area, Dad said, knew him, especially if you were involved in law enforcement, you knew who that was. So that was, that was a cool little tidbit too. Glad you remember that. I'd forgotten he'd said that.
La 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 la. I am not listening to Jeffrey, but he's still talking. I am not listening to you.
I really hate when you do that.
Then stop then, all right?
Childish.
Is that fucking Foley in here?
All right, there's Todd. It's showtime, okay?
Hey, boss, I know what you're gonna say, but
you mind telling me where the fuck you come off going undercover without authorization from me? What the fuck is this all about? You wanna play some fucking bullshit cowboy cop? Go do it in somebody else's precinct.
Don't you wanna hear my side of the story?
What's your fucking side of the story?
Let's hear your side of the story.
Hey, Axel, I'm not taking any more of this shit from you. How much this little stunt of yours gonna cost this city?
I don't think cost is the issue here, sir. I think the issue should be my blatant disregard for proper procedure.
You damn right, wise ass! The mayor called the chief called the deputy chief just chewed my ass out. You see, I don't have any bit of it left, don't you? When the fuck did you get a truckload of cigarettes from anyway?
From the Dearborn hijack.
From the Dearborn hijack? And that fucking bus went down last week. That truck is supposed to be in the damn pound.
I'm trying to tell you.
Jeffrey, this is none of your fucking business.
This is not my locker.
Listen, Axel. No more of these setups, you understand? You're a good cop. And you got great potential, but you don't know every fucking thing. And I'm tired of taking the heat for your ass. One more time, you're out on the street. Do you understand me?
Boss, let me tell you.
Do you understand me?
Yeah, I understand. Boss, The chief ain't chew it all out. You still got a little ass there.
Don't fuck with me, Axel. Not now. Go on. Go home.
Yeah, I had heard that too. I mean, obviously, I didn't know him. I don't know him as a person, but I heard that they said that he was actually a real police officer, and they just pretty much just told him, just like talk to you know, Eddie Murphy like you would talk to anybody else, like just like you would. And they were like, he's like, and he just went for it. And I was like, dude, that is so hilarious.
It's beautiful, you know. It's beautiful. It's dead on Detroit. I mean, it was perfect. And I'm glad. I love it when they do that, when they have people bring in people who specialize in an area they're portraying and just be yourself. It's so much better. So much better.
So let me ask you all both this, because I know, again, as a person who never had a military, at zero experience or understanding of it, just purely like what I know from movies or TV or whatever, like Arleigh Emery was an ex drill sergeant, if I understand correctly. Mm-hmm. And then he became a famous actor who started out doing military type movies.
Right.
So when you watch him do like Full Metal Jacket or whatever, does that feel real, or is that like way Hollywood? And so he amped it up.
Yeah. You know, things are going to be a little, it's going to appear more smooth because everything in Hollywood is streamlined, but it is far more real than dragging some Joe Schmo actor off the street going, play this part. He did a beautiful job in Full Metal Jacket. Perfect. I couldn't.
Yes.
Chris, what do you think? I couldn't have picked. I don't think anybody could have picked a better person to play himself for that part than that man. He did a wonderful job.
No, I don't think there was anybody better suited for Gunnery Sergeant Hartman than, was it Hartman? I think. Than Arleigh Emery. And yes, he was a real live gunnery sergeant in the Marine Corps who was a drill instructor. But he actually, Kubrick hired him to be an advisor, because the guy that was supposed to play the drill instructor was the door gunner in the helicopter. And he's like, how do you kill innocent women and children? He's like, it's easy. You don't lead them as much. That guy was actually supposed to play the drill instructor. So Arleigh Emery would come in and would try to teach him what to do. And Kubrick loved it so much. They're like, you're just going to do it.
Yeah.
But they felt so bad about like taking this other guy out that they gave him the door gunner scene, which in and of itself, he's like one of the most, even though it was so short, he's still one of the most memorable characters of the movie.
He is. When you think about that movie, he's the first person that comes to mind.
Mm-hmm.
It wouldn't have been is great without him.
All right, guys. So, you know, this has been a fun episode. Unfortunately, I have some other previous engagements that I have to get to. But I want to say thank you, Kate, for coming on the show. It's been an absolute pleasure. I hope this isn't the last time we have you on here. This has been so much fun. And it's so good to bring up these old memories.
Yeah, I had a really good time, guys. Thanks for letting me come on. Anytime you want me to look at a movie and throw in my worthless 2 cents, I'm happy to do so. It's nice talking to people my age about, you know, these things and just shooting the breeze. It's as opposed to, you know, I don't know.
Criminals.
Yeah, pretty much. Thank you very much. I had a really good time.
That's awesome.
All right, well, we're going to wrap it up with that. So, yes, I hope you enjoy the additional commentary of the experiment, get a little bit different perspective on that. And we haven't decided what movie or what we're going to do next week, but hopefully if we can have a Bob Lewis cameo. But stay tuned for that.